guys, thank you all for joining us again. We have an outstanding guest with us today, Dr. Peter Antevi. Peter, thank you for coming and talking with us.
Thanks, Jeff.
I think y'all probably know Dr. Antevi's work with pediatric resuscitation, and you may have seen him on, there's a little TV show he was just interviewed on 60 Minutes. I want to talk to you about some pediatric stuff, but first, I'd kind of like to get an idea of what got you into medicine. Where'd you grow up, and how did your path take you to medical school?
First of all, thanks for having me. I've actually followed a lot of what you do, and so kind of sitting here with you is a good time for me. My path is very interesting because I'm basically a first generation American. My parents are from Israel. My grandfather.
Both of your parents?
Both of them. My grandfather is from Iraq. He left there. He went to Palestine many years before it became the state of Israel.
Okay.
And he was a fighter, like a warrior, basically a combat guy. And then he helped Israel become a state. And so he was with very, very smart man, but kind of went to the top of his game, was doing very well in Israel, and then decided that there was this thing called America, and he went on a boat 2 weeks across the ocean. So imagine you have everything in your life.
And this was before Israel was a thing.
So Israel became a state, and then back in, I think it was around the 60s or 70s.
Oh, after the state.
Right, after the state, they were doing very well. He became a builder, very reputable. Apparently they were considered kind of wealthy, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, you know what? I'm taking a, he says to his whole family, wait here. I'll be back. 2 week boat ride, got to New York City, looked around, him and his brothers, and they said, thumbs up. They went back on the boat, 2 weeks, and basically said to the family, we're going. Now imagine
wow.
You had everything, and you just left, and took your whole family with you. They come to Paterson, New Jersey, they bought a piece of property, and my grandfather didn't speak English, so my mom, at the age of like 12 or 13, was at City Hall trying to translate. From here to there, they lost everything. So they went to zero.
Wow.
So they went from Paterson, they said, we have no luck here, let's go to Brooklyn. They go to Brooklyn, my grandfather was learning now how to cut slip covers, plastic slip covers on furniture, just to make it by.
Wow.
They get back on their feet again, they start doing some building again, move down to Florida, finally get back up on their feet, and We grew up very very modest means. I never went to sleepaway camp. I only went to the better school because my dad bartered with the principal. My dad was doing upholstery and curtains, and he said, I'll do that for you if you can put my kids in school. So we grew up with my dad coming home every night at midnight, working his butt off. And my dad doesn't have a high school education. My mom got her degree after, we ended up leaving, high school and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
She was a travel agent. She helped him with his business. And so we grew up watching our parents just kind of work really hard. And so no physicians in my family. And just something about, me growing up, I remember I still have my yearbook from elementary school and it says, I want to be a pediatrician.
Really?
So it's in there. Don't know how that happened, and I guess it was always inside of me, but I knew that's been my calling for my entire life.
That's interesting. So,
not medicine per se, but I knew that I wanted to be in pediatrics for whatever reason.
Help kids. Okay.
Yep.
So that's interesting hearing about your parents. So
yeah.
It takes a lot of balls to just pick up and go to somewhere you know nothing about and risk everything.
Everything it does.
But it also takes an awful lot of work to recover from that.
Yeah.
So you're obviously very successful. Your brothers are also very successful.
Yes.
And all of y'all have become successful by working hard. So it sounds
Correct.
Like that's absolutely something that you you either inherited or you learned by close observation.
I think that the biggest lesson for me was that, everything that happened to my family and like the hard knocks that they took, they never complained about it. And the story is that when my grandfather lost everything, there was no woe is me, there was no I'm going to be on the take. It was, let's just put our head down and just keep working. And so my brothers, 23 years ago, founded a company that they people thought they were crazy with this thing called the internet.
Young kids, right, exactly.
and they put their head down and they just worked really, really hard. And I think that's probably what the observation was,
yeah.
is that you work hard, you don't complain, and also kind of be a free and independent thinker.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not really followers in the sense of if people are saying one thing is true, we're usually on the other side of that. And we feel pretty good about being on the other side of that. So if I'm ever in a situation where I'm thinking the same as everybody else,
mm-hmm.
I'm probably thinking, is there something that
so
I'm missing here?
Well, that's interesting. That may come up again
okay.
in our discussion
okay.
here. So you're clearly comfortable challenging established
yeah.
dogma.
Yeah. I'm a contrarian.
Yeah.
But I'm not an in-your-face contrarian. I just, you know, I'm a very simple-minded guy, right? So things, when I was in medical school, and I started in the Caribbean, and then I went to University of Miami after 2 years.
Oh, for medical school.
Uh-huh.
Which, where?
It was in St. George's in Grenada.
Okay.
So I get there, and I go to get mail for the first day. And we go to this one little room, we're at the window, and there's these big buckets of mail. And I said, you know, Peter Antevi, and the guy goes, he starts going through one bucket, another bucket. 20 minutes later, he gives me the one letter I've been waiting for. And then the line is like a mile long, and every day, the line's a mile long. And I wonder, why isn't there a mail room here?
Uh-huh.
Right? So anyway, make a long story short, I became the class president. Me and my buddy went to the people at the school and said, there's a room there that's not being used. It's an old abandoned hotel, basically, that they refurbished, but one room is empty. I said, give me the room, break down this wall, put a window, have the guys build, you know, 300 mail slots. And within like a week or two, we had an up and running mail room. We had the wives or the spouses of the medical students working it. And you know, so like it's just like you see something that's broken,
yeah.
and my mind just wants to fix it kind of thing in a very simplified fashion.
I like it.
Not too complicated.
So you strike me as someone who's very curious.
Yes.
I'm a huge fan of Richard Feynman.
Okay.
And reading his books where, you know, he was one of the physicists that worked on the Manhattan Project.
Okay.
He writes this book about his lectures and how he just got fascinated with science and wanted to know how something worked. He would see a problem and said, well, I'm going to fix that.
Yeah. That's great.
That's outstanding.
I'll have to read some of his writings.
Oh, it's great. He's got a book called Surely You Can't Say That, Mr. Feynman.
Okay.
It's awesome stuff.
Okay.
So you said you started off in Grenada, then
mm-hmm.
you transferred to Miami.
Mm-hmm.
And you knew you wanted to do pediatrics all along.
Mm-hmm.
What's a nice pediatrician like you doing in a hard knock profession like EMS?
It's not
a straightforward pathway. How'd you get there?
It's a very unusual path that I'm a very big believer that there's opportunity always in front of you. It could be on an elevator. It could be it could be at the park. But I always believe that there's many doors that are in front of you that are just not visible, right? And if you're willing to look and actually find those doors and try to walk through them, then you kind of like you have to kind of make your own luck, if you will. So in pediatrics, I always knew that I was going towards the critical aspect of anything. So I love the ER, I love the ICU. So that was kind of an easy
sick kid kind of guy.
Yeah, sick kid. So you put me there, and I just felt very comfortable. So then, you know, I go to a children's hospital. I mean, after LA, Pittsburgh, I go back home to Florida. I'm working for about 5 years, and I was doing new education at the fire department because I wanted to, you know, just why not?
Mm-hmm.
So I got to know a lot of people. And then there was an opportunity for an EMS medical director job in around 2010. And, you know, I think the bids were going in around the end of 2009. Nurse comes up to me, who I've worked with for many years, and she says, hey, Pete, Davey Fire is looking for a medical director. I said, Marikar, I'm a pediatric ER doctor.
Right.
And she says, well, you know what? They like you. Put your name in.
Yeah.
So what I did, and I said, when's the RFP due? And she says, in a day or two. I'm like, America, really? She's like, do it. So I went home. You know how the RFPs in Florida, you have to write all these things and you have to make 5 copies and you got to turn it in before 5 o'clock. So basically it was a rush job. But what I did was I called my buddy who's an adult EM doc and I said, hey, I'm going for this RFP. I want you to come in with me so that at least I have a chance. Mm-hmm. To make a long story short, somehow by the grace of God, they basically, I made it to the final two, and I guess I, you know, I found favor with there with the fire chief, and they took a chance on me, and
nice.
And that day changed my life. Those people changed my life. So,
So I'm going to come back to that, but you did pediatrics,
mm-hmm.
and then you did emergency medicine.
I did PEDS-EM.
PEDS-EM. So you did the path. Tell us a little bit about that pathway. How you get to be there?
So you do 3 years of PEDS.
Okay.
And then for any subspecialty in PEDS, whether you're going to go to GI, cardio, whatever, it's 3 years.
Okay.
So it's 3 additional years. I did that in Pittsburgh.
Okay.
You could do adult EM,
mm-hmm.
and then 2 years of PEDS to do
right.
PEDS-EM, but PEDS-EM is 3 and 3.
Okay. You're the medical director for the system that took care of the Parkland shooting,
mm-hmm.
And you were there. So, if you don't mind, just kind of give me your thoughts on that,
mm-hmm.
and what your takeaway points were, both as a person who had to
mm-hmm.
watch that and live through it, and as a medical director, what can we learn from the AMSC?
So it's a bit of an emotional topic, but I will start with the kind of just the EMS response, which. You know, I couldn't be more proud of. I'm very blessed to work with teams of leaders that are just phenomenal. Meaning from the fire chief on down, the structure, the level of expertise and caring is just, you know, second to none. Beyond them, the commissioners and the mayor, they're just full support. So anything we want, any training that's necessary, any equipment that we need, we get. Years before Parkland, we were putting in, training that related to stop the bleed. There was training with police and EMS for years that was very cohesive that you probably won't find in many cities around the world. And all that's not has nothing to do with me. I just was blessed to go into a system like that. So, and we had several incidents, if you will. You know, a kid had a gun at a school, so we had some practice on the response. Coral Springs also has its own comm center, and Broward County, in general, has a separate comm center. So Coral Springs has everything kind of encapsulated within it. It's a self-sustaining city with just great resources. Let's start with that. So on the day of the incident, there happened to be SWAT practicing literally up the road. With Dr. Pepe, okay? You happen to have all the chiefs. What are the odds, right? Yeah, all the chiefs basically kind of, you know, at headquarters, and as soon as this thing goes down, they're in their cars and they're on scene. So the first people on scene are upper echelon chiefs who are just, people who are, you know, selfless. They went in, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't like, oh, I'm gonna set up command out here. My fire chief put on a ballistic vest and I ran over a fence and went in to go grab a kid. Like, that's the kind of people that I work with. And so I ended up, so my office is about 15 minutes away. So I took the keys and I just booked it. So as I'm going up the Sawgrass, which is the highway that gets to where I need to go, there's probably a caravan of 50 cop cars undercover. All the SWAT guys were practicing right now where I am. So we're all getting there. I don't have a response vehicle, which is probably a big downside. But I get there.
I did hear you showed up in a stylish ride.
Yeah, well, that was on another scene.
Oh, okay.
Another scene. So this was actually.
Did you
my,
upgrade the ride?
Yeah, it's actually my car.
Not in a minivan.
Wasn't a minivan. So, but now I show up.
This
and
seemed
I,
fitting for a pediatrician.
I took a lot of crap for that.
I'll bet you did.
I pull the car up, and I had to run in like maybe half a mile because basically there just was mayhem.
Yeah.
Little did I know that the shooter wasn't contained. He was out and about, and he was, you know, in the region that I was running through. So he was escaping, and I was kind of running in. looking back, thinking, you know, how unsafe was all this happening.
Right.
In the meantime, he had shot through the third floor windows of the school to try and pick off my medics and the responding police officers and all the students. Thank God that was hurricane proof.
Hmm.
So once he realized he couldn't get through that window, he put down his weapons, took off his outfit, whatever, and he just had a school uniform on.
Hmm.
And he walked out with everybody else. And so
clearly he had thought that through.
He had thought it through. He knew exactly where he was going. He went up in a very programmatic way. And he knew that window was like a bay window, if you will. And he would have got everybody down there. It was a hard day. Let's just put it that way, because you have to understand that the wave of kids that came out who were injured all came out very quickly because, and this is one of the biggest takeaways, law enforcement, you know, Coral Springs law enforcement, SWAT medics, they went in there not just to clear, but they went in there to get these kids out, which is what we trained on. And you probably don't see this everywhere where they just say somebody else will be coming in. The RTF was not allowed in. And we can go into that or not, but basically they weren't allowed in. And you had SWAT and police bringing kids on golf carts out to us. Now, I wasn't there yet. So basically my EMS chief, who did an amazing job, he just said basically, you know, you on that ambulance, you two on that ambulance. So like, let's say like a... maybe like a yellow, and a red and two yellows, or a couple of greens. And so he just basically was just figuring it out and saying, go to that hospital. He did a great job. No triage tags. Just basically eyeballed it. And 17 lives were saved that day. We put on 5 tourniquets, 7 chest seals, essentially before they even came out to us. I came onto the scene.
In that case, who was putting those on? Who was doing that?
That was PD and SWAT on the inside.
Not medics.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
I mean, they're SWAT medics.
Right.
So, but it's not standard of who you would think would be putting them on. Not, you know, come on outside or wait for the RTF to come in.
Right.
That, none of that happened. All those kids who came out of that day with a pulse are all perfectly normal today. I mean, 100%. Now, imagine if that building would have been shut down and, you know, nobody allowed in kind of thing, nobody allowed out either,
Yeah. Which
has always been my biggest fear. You would have had 34 people deceased that day. So when I look back at the day, I'm very proud of what my team did, just proud to be associated and affiliated with that, you know, with that type of expertise and those level of people.
Yeah.
So that's kind of, and of course, there's still a lot of emotion that I'm trying to keep down in there. But I would say that from as horrific of a day that it was, we can definitely see the positive. Now, obviously, in the news and the media, there's a whole lot of other things, and a lot of that's still under investigation. So I'm not going to go there. But from the medical side, as a medical director, I will say that when they did the final review of the medical aspects of this, I mean, we couldn't have been more proud of what those findings were. So
I'm a big believer that good things can come from really bad situations.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a horrible situation.
Yeah.
What types of things have you learned from that sort of mass violent event that you would recommend other agencies think about adopting?
Well, I mean, there's so many lessons learned here. First is practice and prepare, right? So hope is not a strategy. And it turns out, I'll bring Dr. Pepe back into this, he was with me 4 days prior, so February 10th, on a Saturday morning at 7:30 in the morning, we were at our training academy, training up 5 cities' mayors and commissioners on Stop the Bleed, CPR. We put them in bunker gear. They were, you know, cutting open cars. So like we brought them in to say, This is what we give you here.
Mm-hmm.
This is what we want you to learn, because we want to teach everybody else the same thing. So we had been teaching Stop the Bleed for years prior to this, with tourniquets out in the community. So we had really kind of ramped that up, and that's number one. you know, the second lesson learned for me, and I would tell everybody, is the police involvement, practicing with the police. So based on what happened in Coral Springs, now in my other city, a little bit to the south, Davie Fire, now we have MCI Mondays.
Okay.
MCI Mondays are PD and EMS every Monday, 5 p.m. to 10 p.m., and they just keep practicing the same thing so that there's unified command, which is kind of a hard concept for a lot of people, especially in the law enforcement side. Because, you know, we would have MCI drills where we'd have PD here, we'd have, you know, our incident commander on the fire side here, and no one's talking. They have no idea what's going on between each other during the drill. And then my RTF is standing out here during a drill, and by the time they get to the first patient, it's been 40 minutes during a drill. So, but that's not the Coral Springs side. That's a little further south.
Mm-hmm.
That's been fixed based on what we learned from Coral Springs. Having PD be the ones who are actually providing care, big lesson. The next thing is having the lay public understand that they are the first responder. We learned a lot from our dispatch, who were giving amazing instructions to the people who were injured. And we have, you know, the ability of giving them instructions. We have APCO in Coral Springs. So I have, you know, full ability to make those modifications.
Mm-hmm.
So layperson is a responder. Dispatch is a responder. PD is the third responder. And then EMS, finally, the fourth responder. But it turns out, and Paul made a good point today, that the fourth responder, us, has to engage and enact all those three prior ones. So we, as EMS in a community, make all those things happen, make the chain of command happen. So if we're not out at schools, so Heath Meyer, one of my chiefs at Davie Fire, he's constantly out at schools, businesses, teaching CPR, stop the bleed. Justin Perinello, another one of my captains in Coral Springs, has taught thousands and thousands of people. Lay people, every employee of the city has been taught. I mean, so like the amount of work that, you know, these people have taken on their own time to put into this type of care and practice really comes out on a day like that. And so those are some of just the basics. Now the radios were an issue.
Sure.
I'm now looking into some alternative type of communication, which I'll show you after. We started a WhatsApp group, which now with one text, I can notify all the players, from hospital to EMS to nurses to whoever is on my group. I've done that. The emotional well-being is a big one. And we basically, does anyone ever practice on the emotional MCI that's occurring? Right. Does anyone ever say, okay, we're having an MCI drill and we're going to engage the wellness folks? We did that on the scene that day. We had like central command, basically, of a wellness command at our headquarters the next day, full of people that you would have thought was there for like some event. They were just strictly there for us. And they came from Palm Beach and Orlando and New York and you name it. And it was set up prior. This wasn't something that we just kind of patched together.
Yeah.
That's what my fire chief did. My fire chief basically had brought in five kind of what he calls clinicians, and now we're bringing one of them on staff, if you will. They're going to have, you know, the Class A's, the whole thing, even though they have their own private practice. So the membership recognizes that person is one of us. So when anyone has a problem, they're going to go to Sean, and Sean is one of us. And so there's a lot of things that we've done that we're now really ramping up on the emotional well-being side. I mean, I have never gone through therapy in my life, right? I went through several sessions that were really very helpful for me. You know, talking about it now is helpful for me. But I just think that those, you know, months and months afterwards have been very difficult. My wife went to that school. She was the first graduating class from that school. You know, I have friends' kids who died at that school.